Be in the house of the Lord. Thank you to our wonderful worship team. And have you enjoyed the worship and how it was focused on the person of the Holy Spirit? And I want to maybe start there this morning and say that, and I know you know this because we're the church, but we have to preach the gospel. And we serve a triune God, God the Father. And He revealed Himself in the Old Testament. And He made a family for Him with the tribes of Israel. He formed family. God is in the business of family, by the way. He's the giver, the creator, the architect of the family unit. One man, one husband, one man, one wife coming together before God. One husband, one wife saying, Lord, we submit to Your covenant. That's the basis of family. If you want a healthy family, you have to think about that. Amen. We can't let the world dictate to us what family is. God is the God of family, made family for Him. And He revealed Himself Himself as Yahweh in the Old Covenant. And then He revealed Himself in the New Testament through His Son, Jesus Christ. Colossians 1 says that Jesus came, and in Jesus we saw the heart of the Father. When the disciples asked Jesus to show them the Father, Jesus said, but I have been with you all this time. Have you not seen the Father? He reveals the Father heart. And then after Jesus died, He was raised from the dead on the third day. And He spent some time with His disciples. As a matter of fact, that same day of His resurrection in the evening, He appeared to His disciples as they were meeting. And their meeting was all about the rumors that Jesus was raised from the dead. And so He appeared to them there. Can you imagine? They wanted to meet to understand what's happening. People are saying the tomb is empty. Where's Jesus? And even as they had these discussions, Jesus was there in their midst. What did He say? He said to them, peace be to you. The next thing He does is He says, as the Father sent me, so I send you. After that, He breathed on them. He says, receive the Holy Spirit. He then instructed them to go and wait in the upper room. And wait actually in Jerusalem. We know they gathered in the upper room together with the 120. Until the Holy Spirit was given. 40 days after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, His ascension had taken place. 10 days later, on the 50th day, the gift of the Holy Spirit was for the first time given in this unique manner to people. So we're not celebrating 50 days. That's where we get the word penta from. The Greek word for 50 is penta. But we're not celebrating 50 days. Pentecost just means on the 50th day, by the way. But how many of you will agree that's not what we celebrate here today? We celebrate the person. We celebrate that. And it's also not an historic event that had taken place, because some people say that the gift of the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, ended with the apostolic age. Newsflash. I don't get anything of that in the Bible. The receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit did not end with the apostolic age. He is still, the person of the Holy Spirit is still just as real today as He was in the days of Jesus, as He was in the days of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And that is why we sang this morning, and it's the Holy Spirit who we honor. So today we honor the Holy Spirit. But I want you to understand that we cannot also only honor Him once a year when we have Pentecost Sunday. And now once a year we have Pentecost conferences and services, because here's the thing, the Holy Spirit lives in you. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. And we are supposed to depend on the Holy Spirit to guide and lead us in every area and aspect of our lives. We can't make something of the Holy Spirit only once a year. We have to make something of Him every day, every moment. He leads us because the Father revealed Himself to the people in the Old Covenant. In the New Testament, it was Jesus. But on the day of Pentecost, the Church of Jesus Christ was born. A new era, a new dispensation had dawned. And it's called the dispensation of the Holy Spirit. So what is this business with only honoring the Holy Spirit once a year? No. When you get up in the morning, you have to welcome Him. And you have to be mindful of Him and become sensitive of Him, because your body, my body, 1 Corinthians 6, I'm just quoting, is a temple of the Holy Spirit. That's why we cannot do what we want, because we are sensitive to the presence of God in us. And so on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came like a mighty rushing wind. The church was born, and the Bible says that the upper room shook. It came as a mighty, like a violent wind we sang this morning, a mighty wind, a rushing wind. And that was the manifestation of the presence of the Holy Spirit. It doesn't mean the Holy Spirit is a wind, or is a dove, or is a fire, or is oil. But we find these manifestations of His presence so that we can know Him as a person. How many of you know that the Holy Spirit is a person? He's the third person in the Godhead. He's a real person, and He wants intimacy with you. That's why Paul said, he says, the love of God be with you, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the fellowship, and the Greek word there means intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit, be with you. So God wants us to have a relationship with the third person of the Holy Spirit. And so tongues of fire came and was divided and sat on each one in the upper room. That's what happened on that day. And so right after that, we see that people started to speak in tongues. Which means what? Which means that they were supernaturally enabled by the Holy Spirit to speak in tongues that they could not understand. By the way, if you want to understand tongue speaking, that's what you need to understand first and foremost, that you can never understand what you're saying. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been needed for the Holy Spirit to enable you to speak that. So the speaker of that tongue cannot understand it, unless the Holy Spirit interprets, reveals, or as we find in the book of Acts, in that account of the day of Pentecost, that some of the other people came because they heard this rushing wind, they heard this fire, this commotion happening. How many of you understand that when the Holy Spirit comes, it's amazing, it's powerful, it's supernatural, hallelujah. It cannot be natural when the Holy Spirit is present, I'm sorry. It cannot be ordinary, it cannot be silent. It cannot be. There's a joy. Something is happening. I pray that something will happen in your heart this morning. I pray that something will happen in your family, in our communities, our schools, our universities. It can only happen when the Holy Spirit comes. Hallelujah. That's why, by the way, that's why we sing songs about revival. So the Holy Spirit had come. People came to see, what's this commotion? What's happening? What's happening here? They heard the people speaking in tongues. They said, but how is it possible for these people to understand our languages? Because we hear they praise God in a language that they don't know, but we know. The Bible says they were empowered by the Holy Spirit and they started to speak in tongues. Now, that's not the only kind of tongue there is. Because right after that, some of the people say, no, we don't understand anything that's happening here. These people are drunk. You can go and read it. I know you don't want to hear about being drunk in church, but that's what you get in the Bible. So the people were mocking them and says, but this is a party going on here. This is a party. These people, we don't understand what they say, what they do. You are drunk. It's then when Peter stood up and said, but these people are not drunk. This is the fulfillment of the prophecy of the prophet Joel, that in the last days I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Turn to somebody and ask them, are you flesh? Are you blood? Because then God wants to pour out His spirit on you, revive your heart, give you life, because where the spirit is, there is life. Where the Spirit is, there is life. As a matter of fact, we can't sing, we can't preach, we can't understand the Word of God, we can't worship. There's nothing we can do without the Holy Spirit. He brings life. I don't care how many times you've studied the Bible and how far you are have advanced academically when it comes to theology. If you do not know the Holy Spirit, you will always interpret the Bible wrong. The Bible can only be interpreted through the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And therefore, it's so crucial that we have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, because He's the one who leads us in the full truth. He's called the Spirit of Truth. So we need the Holy Spirit. So Peter had to correct these accusers who said, but these guys are drunk. He says, no, they are not drunk. In the last days, God will pour out His Spirit on all flesh. He says, your young men will see dreams, visions. Your older men will prophesy. And he begins to talk about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And then later he says this, and we can go to the scripture in Acts chapter 2, verse 38 to 39. Peter then said the following, as he's preaching, remember he's been accused. They are being accused of having a party and certain people are drunk. And then he said the following, Peter replied, each of you must repent. Remember, the church has just started now. This is the birth of the church. He says, so now this is the message. You have to repent. The word repent in the Greek is the word metanoia. And it means you become aware of your sinful state and you say, Lord, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, and I'm prepared, Lord, to be changed in my mind and changed in my heart. And from now on, speak differently, talk differently, think differently, plan differently, do differently. That's what Peter was saying. Metanoia. Repent. Turn to somebody and say, repent. Okay. Just making sure you're still with me. Okay. Repent. He says, you must repent of your sins and do what? And turn to God. That is the gospel 101 there. That's where it starts. Well, it starts with Jesus. He says, repent, turn to God, and do what? The Greek word is baptizo, be immersed underwater. Why? Because there's an old man that needs to be buried, and a new man that has to be raised with Christ, being filled with the Holy Spirit and live a new life. Gospel basics. He says, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. How many of you know that there is only one who can forgive sins, and His name is Jesus Christ? More than 2,000 years ago, He died on the cross. He shed His blood in 7 different places. 3 days later, He was raised from the dead. Christian power comes from the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and is manifested in our lives through the person of the Holy Spirit. Can we honor the Holy Spirit here this morning? And Jesus and the Father. Can we give our God a big praise in this place? Hallelujah. He says, so for the forgiveness of sins, then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Say with me, the gift. I want you to know that the Holy Spirit is a gift. Baptism in the Holy Spirit is a gift. A gift that God has given to everyone, every man, every woman who will say, I believe in Jesus Christ, believe in my heart, confess with my mouth that He is the Son of God. There's no other. He said of Himself, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I am the life. Can somebody say hallelujah? I don't know how it is, but when I talk about the basics of the gospel, I always get excited. I sense the power in it, the power to restore, the power to deliver, the power to forgive sins, the power to get your name written in heaven's book of life, the power to give hope, hallelujah, the power to stir joy. I always get excited when it comes to gospel basics, because it's changed my life, and it can change your life if you open your heart and accept Him. So He says in verse 39, so this promise is to you. So God promises the gift of the Holy Spirit. You have to understand that nobody's ever received the Holy Spirit like the 120 in the upper room. Prior to that, nobody's ever received the gift. Now, for the first time, and I would like to say apart from Jesus, because He received the Holy Spirit as a human being in a very unique manner after He was baptized by John the Baptist. Got up from the Jordan River. The Bible says, and the Spirit of God descended upon Him like a dove. The Holy Spirit's not a dove, but His presence, the manifestation of His presence was described. And I believe there's a meaning to it, and I don't want to get into that today. But now, for a second time, people receive the gift. Say with me, the gift. I want to ask you on Pentecost, have you received the gift of the Holy Spirit? You see, because up until this point, we see that the Holy Spirit was with people. We're not saying that the Holy Spirit wasn't with people, but Jesus made a promise. He says, at this day, the Holy Spirit will come. You will receive Him as a gift, and He will no longer just be with you, but He will also be in you so that He can become upon you. And streams of living water will gush forth from your innermost man, and you will never be the same again. And nobody who comes in contact with you can ever be the same again. That's what we're celebrating. We're celebrating the Holy Spirit Precious Holy Spirit, come. Have your way. Holy Spirit, lead us, guide us, touch us. It says, then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is to you and to your children. This promise is to and your. So he speaks of generations. What am I saying? This means that the Holy Spirit receiving him as a gift did not end with the apostolic age. I want you to clearly grasp this, because there are many doctrines out there that says that the gift of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, the gifts, whether it's tongue speaking, prophecy, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, and there are many more gifts, leadership gifts, unique gifts from the Holy Spirit. These gifts stopped. This empowerment stopped when the apostles died. But yet Peter said, no, it's for your children and generations to come, because he says in verse 39, it's to your children and those far away. He speaks of coming generations, far away, all who have been called by the Lord. Galatians 4 verse 6, and because we are God's children, he sent the Spirit of his Son into your hearts. God has sent the Holy Spirit into our hearts. That also refers to the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit with us becomes the Holy Spirit in us. That's the gift of the Holy Spirit. But you cannot come to salvation without the Holy Spirit, because when you hear the Word of God, the Bible says faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. And the Holy Spirit does a work there. He prompts you to surrender your life. This is why you will see sometimes people struggle. Why? Because all of a sudden they become aware of the Holy Spirit who speaks to them to surrender their lives to Jesus. And that's why we have altar calls on Sunday mornings. Amen. There has to be a moment where you respond in faith to the Word of God and say, I need you, Lord. And if you try to do that through a system, through protocol, because we've got many different denominations, many different systems and protocols. If you just want to try to follow a protocol and think that now you are mechanically saved, you're in for a big surprise, because we serve a God of relationship. You must respond in faith and believe in Jesus Christ. You need to make a decision. You need to act upon the word you've heard and then say yes. And the Holy Spirit helps you there. Because 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 3 says, nobody can say that Jesus is Lord without the Holy Spirit. So there's a work of the Holy Spirit taking place there. And God sends him into our heart. And that is why I can boldly say we were called to be like Jesus, because we've received the same Holy Spirit and we've also received the DNA and the nature of Jesus Christ. Say with me, be like, live like, and especially love like who? Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That's why we've received the Holy Spirit, so that we can be like, live like, love like. He's also our Parakletos, our comforter, our strengthener, our counselor, our helper. The one Parakletos means the one called to our side to guide and to lead and to aid us. And we just want to honor the person of the Holy Spirit here this morning. And I pray that as I preach the gospel, that a desire come in your heart to be closer to him, because you can be baptized by the Holy Spirit and not close to him. Can I get a big amen there? I know so many, I've been in ministry for a number of years, and I've seen so many people stop to be in fellowship with the Holy Spirit. But 10 years ago, they were filled with the gift of the Holy Spirit. They were baptized in the Holy Spirit. But now they are led by their flesh. They are led by social media. They are led by their minds, by their thoughts. They're no longer led by the Holy Spirit. How do you know that you are still in fellowship and relationship with the Holy Spirit? You are being led by the Holy Spirit on a moment-to-moment basis. You know he's leading you. You know you depend on him. You depend on him. If you're not led by him, you'll be led by something else. I can promise you that. And so we can talk on and on about the Holy Spirit, his function, his work. But I would like to quickly, for the next few minutes, focus on a title of the Holy Spirit that we do not always talk about. I believe it's going to be a great blessing because once we understand this work of the Holy Spirit, your identity in Christ will be established. And that's what I'm after here this morning. That's my mission, that you will understand who you are, what you are, whose you are, where you are, and where you're heading. Because we're all heading somewhere, hallelujah. Whether you like to know it or not, we're going places, hallelujah. Okay. And the title I refer to is the Spirit of Adoption. Everybody say with me, the Spirit of Adoption. The Word of God says in Romans 8, verse 15, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption. As a matter of fact, I would like for us to read this together. 1, 2, 3. The Spirit you received, adoption to sonship, or daughtership, or childship, if there's a word like that. Understand? So, and then he says, and by him, what do? We cry, Abba, Father. And I would like to talk to you about this verse today, just for a moment. Because, you see, here's what the Holy Spirit will do. The Holy Spirit makes us the family of God. You remember, I started off by saying that family is important to God. He created family. And the dynamics of a Christian family, of a godly family. Now, I want to show you today how the Holy Spirit of Adoption comes and makes you God's family. The Spirit of Adoption. He comes and He makes you the family of God. The Word of God says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21 to 22, it is God who enables us, along with you, to stand firm for Christ. He has commissioned us, verse 22, and He has identified us as His own. God has identified you and me as His own. How did He do that? By placing the Holy Spirit in our hearts. You see, so when we receive the Holy Spirit in our hearts, the fullness of the Holy Spirit, the gift that Peter referred to in our previous text, that is how God knows that we are His children. And so the point is that the Holy Spirit has a work to do when it comes to our adoption to being the children of God. And here's what happens, because the moment you believe in Jesus Christ, because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, the Holy Spirit comes. Can you remember what Jesus said to Nicodemus, who came to see Him? He says, you have to be born of the Spirit and of water. Can you remember that? So the moment you say yes to Christ, you put your hand up, you say, I surrender my life here today. What will happen is the Holy Spirit of Adoption starts to work to make you family. Jesus also said in John chapter 1, I think verse 12 or 14, He says, to all who have accepted Him, to Him He gave the right to become. Say with me, there's a becoming. That becoming is the process of your adoption. The Holy Spirit does a work. He makes you the family of God. I don't know about you, but that's exciting news to me. Because I am family. I am part of a heavenly, supernatural, great family. Not only the family we see here today being brothers and sisters, but we're also part of a heavenly family. We're all part. Turn to somebody and say, we are family. My brother, my sister. Ek is sommer liever vir jou hier vanoggend. You see, here's what the Holy Spirit does. The Spirit of Adoption. The moment you say yes to Jesus, He comes and He regenerates your heart. He restores your heart. He gives you the nature of Jesus. Your spiritual heart begins to go like this, beep, 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 beep. It doesn't go beep anymore, it goes beep. You get what I'm saying? That is what rebirth is all about. You have been born in the natural from a biological mother and father, but now there's another birth that had taken place. Why? Because you've believed in Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit comes, regenerates, gives you the nature of Jesus Christ. Your spiritual heart comes alive because prior to that, your spirit was dead. Prior to that, there was death, but it's only the Spirit who brings life. Hallelujah. And your spiritual heart begins to go beep, beep, beep. And you are now a child of God, a son of God, a daughter of God. The Holy Spirit has made you the family of God. Of God, and that's what I want you to see. And now God, when He sees you, He sees His Spirit, He sees the nature of Jesus Christ, and He says, there's my son, there's my daughter. And that is why religion cannot save you, because religion cannot do this. Religion cannot do this. Serving God mechanically through our deeds cannot save you. We are saved by faith in Jesus Christ. And I've given you a glimpse of what the Holy Spirit of adoption comes to do. And that's where the adoption starts. And now the Holy Spirit comes and He presents you and me as a child of God. How many children of God do we have here this morning? So, I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. And so I want to just quickly show you what adoption is all about. The first thing is that you are now a child and an heir. Not heir like the air we breathe, but heir, erfgenaam, heir. You are an inheritor. How many of you are excited about that? Listen to the word of God. So say with me, children and heirs. What are we talking about? The spirit of adoption. What does that mean? What does that mean? Quickly ask somebody, what does it mean that I'm adopted? What does it mean? Make sure they're not sleeping. If you watch by way of streaming, no, don't worry, nobody's sleeping. It's just for me to get to prepare the hearts of people because I'm about to say something important. So say with me, I'm a child and an heir. Listen to the word of God. What are we doing? We're celebrating the person of the Holy Spirit. It's Pentecost Sunday. Hallelujah. So the word of God says the Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. The Holy Spirit will testify with your heart and your spirit that you are a child of God. And therefore, I'm always at liberty to ask people, are you sure you're a child of God? Because if you have the Holy Spirit and you are a child of God, you will have certainty in your heart. How many times do I minister to people in hospital halls and rooms, and I ask them, are you certain? And I won't get into all the many different answers I get, but I can tell you, 8 out of 10 times people are not certain, but I want you to know that if you are in fellowship with the Holy Spirit, you can be certain that you're a child of God. Hallelujah. So in verse 17, he says, now if we are children, then we are heirs. The Greek word for heir there is kleronomos. Say with me, kleronomos. Yes, you've learned a new Greek word yet again. But what does that mean? And I quickly want you to look at here at the bottom of the screen, an heir, a kleronomos, our definition here, is someone who inherits, basically. You have inherited something. We'll talk about it. You are an heir, you've inherited something, and carries forward the work of a predecessor. And I want you to understand who you are, whose you are, where you are, what you're supposed to do, because many people only focus on the blessing of being an heir, but they don't focus on the mission. We got to focus on the mission. Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost. John wrote in 1 John chapter 3, he says, let me just see here. Yes, so Jesus came to seek and save those who were lost. I think it's 1 John 3:16 where Jesus said, as I laid out, actually John said to his audience, he says, just as Jesus laid down his life, so you ought to lay down your lives. So being a predecessor means that it's not just getting into the blessing message, but it's also understanding there's a call upon our life to love and appreciate those around us, and even to pay the price to the extent where we lay down our lives. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't worry, I've got your back. I've got your back. You see, we have to make this practical. Amen. Yeah, so that's not 1 John 3:2. 1 John 3:16 is just a verse that popped to my mind. So you can go and read that. But that's the mission of Jesus. And that's what we do to continue the work of our predecessor. That's what an heir does. Come on, somebody, say amen. So the word of God then says in verse 17, he says, you are heirs and co-heirs with Christ. Why does he say co-heirs with Christ? Because Christ Jesus is a son of God. He's the Son of God. He's the only begotten Son of God. And now when the Spirit of God adopts us, we become sons and daughters of God. So Jesus Christ is our eldest brother in the Lord. And please, I say this with great sensitivity and respect, because we are not God, we are not Jesus, but we do have His nature. We do have His DNA. The Word of God says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, dear friends, we are already God's children, but He has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like Him. Say this with me, I will be like Jesus. I don't know about you, but it's something that excites me. So So being an heir of God also means there's a future glory that awaits you. I'm trying to tell you today who you are and what you're part of. Are you excited with me? You are a child, which means if you are a child, you are an heir of God. That's why the Word of God says, if we go back to the previous scripture, if indeed we share in His sufferings, we talked about that last week. Now, you can just stick to where you are. Thank you. I appreciate you guys there. I just see smiles there from the back. So just look at verse at Romans 8:15. He says, so heirs, kleronomos, co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in His suffering, in order that we may also share in His glory. And I just want to tell you that you are called to share in the glory of Jesus Christ in future. Being an heir means, number one, that you have all the access to everything the Lord has promised you here and now, but there's also a future glory. But He speaks of suffering, which means you need to take up your cross. You need to continue the work of your predecessor. Seek and save the lost. Lay down your life for others as He laid down His life for you and me. And you see, here's the message that we don't always want to hear. We don't want to hear that we cannot just live for ourselves. Well, I'm not saying we as a church. I'm talking about other churches again. I know this church understands that there's a laying down of our own lives. Even if that doesn't mean you die physically, you have to die to self so that you don't just live for yourself, because that's who your predecessor are. Say with me, be like, live like, love like Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit of adoption. And give the Holy Spirit a big praise and honor Him. It's Pentecost Sunday. So first and foremost, say with me, I'm an heir. And I want to say this to you, you have access to salvation, access to deliverance. You have access, my friend, access to healing, access to provision, access to protection. But that's not the only thing that Kleronomos refers to. It refers to that future glory where we will see Jesus as Jesus is. And it also refers to the mission of Jesus that has to continue or be continued in this world. So secondly, when the Holy Spirit comes and He adopts us, that also means that now we are delivered from fear and slavery. I want you to know that the Holy Spirit we receive sets you free from your fear, from your anxiety, from your pressure, from your stress, from your worrying. The enemy doesn't do that. Demonic spirits, what do? The Holy Spirit makes you family. Demonic spirits enslaves and instill fear in your life. But God wants you to know that you do not need to be afraid, because you are family. In this family, you are protected. Capish? Yeah, it sounds a little bit like mafia, but you are protected. You are protected in the family of God, this wonderful, heavenly, supernatural family. And the Holy Spirit comes and presents you and testifies with your heart and my heart that we are now children of God. How many of you are excited that you're a child of God? Hallelujah. And now He says, you do not need to be afraid. You're not a slave of fear. Because in the context of Romans 8, where He speaks of the spirit of adoption, He says the following: the spirit you received does not make you slaves. Listen to me, church, you are not a subject of God that has a little religion, you know, and if you don't operate, God throws you out. Christianity doesn't work like that. The Holy Spirit comes, the Bible says, and He makes you family. Where's the scripture? The spirit you receive does not make you a slave. You're not a slave. You're not a subject of God. You're a child of God. There are verses in the Word of God that says you are God's friend. But we have to be very careful when we talk about that, so that we never think that we are God. Hallelujah. He says, so that you live in fear again. God doesn't want you to be afraid. Rather, the spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship, and by Him we cry, Abba, Father. So here's what I want you to understand. We celebrate the Holy Spirit. He makes us the family of God, children and heirs. And then He delivers us from fear and sets you free. I want you to understand this. You don't need to be afraid. What are you afraid of? I've seen many Christians, people who serve God for a long time, living in fear, bound by fear, financial fear, fear for the future, fear for failure, fear for something that's going to happen which they're really afraid of. And I want you to know that God doesn't want you to be afraid anymore. You are part of His family. The Holy Spirit comes, the Spirit of adoption. He doesn't make you a slave. He makes you a child so that you do not need to fear. So many people walk around with fear. What's the end of your fears, my friend? The end of your fears is depression. The end of fears is worrying. God speaks to somebody right now. You are afraid. How will I provide for my family? What will become of my future? What will become of my job? God sets you free. I've come here this morning to deliver you of your fear. I minister to you right now in Jesus' name. The Spirit of adoption is here. And He comes and He says, you are not a subject. You are not a slave to fear, but you are a child of God. My child, I've got a good plan for you. Come to me. Open your heart for me. And I'm going to lift you up and make a way for you. And even if you go through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll be there with you. When the waters come, when the fire come, they will not overwhelm you. Can you not remember what happened to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that there was a fourth man with them? You are my child, you are protected, and you do not need to be afraid. I set you free of your fear, of your anxiety, and your stress right now in Jesus' name. What will the sermon mean this morning if we don't see the power of the Holy Spirit manifesting everything that Jesus paid for us to have? I want to say that one more time. What will the service be if we do not celebrate the power of the Holy Spirit that manifests, listen, everything Jesus paid for you and me to have? That's what the Spirit of adoption does. 2 Timothy 1 verse 7 says, for God has not given you a spirit of fear and timidity, but of love, power, discipline, sound mind, whatever translation you prefer. Say with me, I don't have a spirit of fear. This is Pentecost. I'm reminded of the power of the Holy Spirit in me. You have not received the spirit of fear. The elections are upcoming. You know, you get two groups of people. Some just ignore it and they just see election day as an off day, as a holiday. Where, you know, some people understand we are in a pivotal place as a country. We need to pray, we need to seek God, but we do not need to be afraid. I want to prophesy God has a good plan for our nation and our country. He's not done with South Africa. He's not done with you and me. All I see is hope. And I pray that you will get hope in your spirit here this morning. In Jesus' name, we serve a good God, irrespective of the outcome. God is still in control in Jesus' name, irrespective of the outcome. Hallelujah. So, you've not received the spirit of fear, but of and timidity, but of power. Say with me, power, love, discipline, discipline, discipline. Got to get up in the morning and pray. Got to seek God, discipline, hallelujah. Got to bring up your children in a fear of the Lord. You've got a responsibility, discipline. Have to be faithful, discipline. We can't have this kind of weak Christianity where we do whatever we want, get ourselves a few prophets, you know, that prophesy a new car, a new wife, a new house, more money. No, no, no. We're not going to have a Christianity like that. Can I get a big amen? Yeah, because when you're into that, you will be afraid. You need to be afraid. Hallelujah. Okay, so, And can I say this, church? You don't even need to be afraid of dying. There are people here, you're afraid of death, and we have people here that works with death every day, by the way. I want to tell you, you don't need to be afraid of dying. I was a young boy when the enemy wanted, by the way, fear torments people. When you can't sleep, when you're stressed out, when you're anxious, it's tormenting. Some people are tormented with this fear for death. I break that fear over you right now in Jesus' name. The Holy Spirit of adoption, who regenerated your heart, give you the DNA of Jesus Christ, will not leave you when the moment comes for you to leave this world and enter the next world. In Jesus' name, you do not need to be afraid of that. He will not leave you. Listen to the word of God in Hebrews 9 verse 14. The word of God says, for by the power of the eternal Spirit, who is the eternal Spirit? The Holy Spirit. The Spirit of adoption. Glory to God. The Spirit that God offered to you and me as a gift. You know, a gift is a wonderful thing. All you do with a gift is you receive it. You're excited about a gift. Sadly, so many people are afraid of the gift of the Holy Spirit. Please, you can be afraid of other stuff, but you cannot be afraid of the Holy Spirit, because when He comes, He delivers you from all kinds of fear. Turn to somebody and say, come on, let's just have the gift and receive the gift. Church, some of you have not received the gift of the Holy Spirit. You don't want to because you're afraid. You've heard too many things. You can't be afraid. God has given a gift. You must receive Him. He's also the eternal Spirit. And He's the Spirit who helped Jesus, who empowered Jesus to lay down His life. Hebrews 9:14 says it, for by the Spirit, the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered Himself to God. Say with me, by the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered. Christ laid down His life, because the Word of God says to God, as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. If you study the context of Hebrews 9, it speaks about the death of our predecessor, Jesus Christ, so that we can be in covenant with God, family with God, hallelujah, heirs with God, not be afraid, be bold, hallelujah. I pray that the Holy Spirit will get a hold of you here this morning, in Jesus' name, hallelujah. I pray that we will experience a little bit of the chaos on the day that they have experienced on the day of Pentecost. By the way, that's called revival. How many of you yearn for revival? Revival. Lord, revive us. Pour out Your Spirit upon us, on Your people. Holy Spirit, we invite You. I pray, Lord, that You will help us, that we will walk in intimacy with Your Spirit. And if you do, you won't be afraid when your time comes, because this world is not your home anymore. The day you gave your heart and life to Jesus, that was the very day heaven became your home. Already, say with me, heaven is already my home. It's your home country. It's not going to be one day your home country. It's the day you gave your heart and life to Jesus and became family. The Bible makes it very clear that heaven is already your home, which means that now you are an alien in this world. You represent your kingdom. That's why, please, I don't want to hear your opinion. I want to hear the Word of God. I want to hear the standard, Jesus Christ. Please, I'm not interested in your philosophy. I'm interested in the standard, the Word of God, the constitution of the kingdom of heaven. Because let your kingdom come, let your will be done, Lord, through the power of your Holy Spirit. That's why that room shook on the day of Pentecost. There was a manifestation of kingdom and the order and the love and grace of God in that place. This is the message of the kingdom of God, church. It's not a message of a man or a message of a denomination. Can I get a big amen in this place? Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. So the Word of God then continues to say in Hebrews 9 verse 14, by the eternal Spirit. So the point is, you don't need to be afraid of death. Don't need to be afraid of death. Say with me, I'm not afraid of dying. Our time's up. I want to conclude. I just want to say this. This fear of death came to me when I was a young man. In primary school still. I think I just came into primary school. I was very young. When I one day realized that I will cease to exist in this world at a certain point in time. And, you know, there was no sermon to help me. I had to deal with that. And I didn't know how to ask my parents to help me. And it might be a fear of death for you that you battle with, that your family doesn't know, that your children doesn't know, that your parents doesn't know. But I just want you to understand today. I want you to understand today that you do not need to be afraid, because there's a spirit of adoption that has made you the family of God. And when time comes for you even to leave this world, whether it's death, whether it's whatever, but when we talk about death, that He will be there to help you and to support you, and to He's still going to be the comforter in that moment. What are you afraid of? You don't need to be afraid. And here's the good news. He regenerated your heart, gave you new birth, the DNA of Jesus, presented you as family, delivered you from being a slave, make you an heir, bring you into the covenant, take you out of this world into the next world, empower you to do that as he helped Jesus. And He's not done even after that, because the Word of God says after you've died, He will come and be involved in you receiving your glorified body at the second coming of Jesus Christ. The Word of God says in Hebrews 8 verse 11, and if the Spirit of God who raised up Jesus from the dead lives in you, does He live in you? It's Pentecost this morning. I must ask the question. Does he live in you? I'm not asking you if the Holy Spirit is involved with you like he is with all believers and with all people, even through the old covenant. I'm asking you, have you received the gift of the Holy Spirit? Because the Word of God says, if the Spirit of God who raised up Jesus from the dead lives in you, he will make your dying bodies live again after you die. What does that mean? That means that you and I will receive a glorified body similar to the body Jesus Christ received. Now, 1 John 3:2 makes sense because the Word of God says we will see him as he is. We're going to be clothed with a new and glorified body in time to come. And the Holy Spirit is going to be involved in that. And then he's still not going to leave us because he's God and we're going to be with him. Amen. But I want you to see this role of adoption. I've not heard many messages on the Holy Spirit of adoption. And I think this is the aim, that it will establish you, your identity in God today. You are not your own. You're not here to represent yourself. You are the family of God. We have the same nature, the same DNA. We go to the same place. We have the same call on our lives to seek and save the lost and to lay down our lives for one another as heirs. We have the same access to the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Say with me, we under the tree. Glory to God. We're all under this tree of the kingdom of God. Can I get a big amen? And we are together, and that's who you are. You're not something else, someone else. As a matter of fact, we are all individual people here today. But, you know, that doesn't mean that we should pry in our individualism. We all have the DNA of Jesus Christ. And our desire is all to be more like him, live more like him, love more like him. Jesus is the standard. Jesus, if you're a young person here today and you are running after models and influencers, I want to help you out. Run after Jesus. And if you want to run after a person and want to be discipled, make sure you get a man and a woman of God, you know, that sets the bar, that chase after Jesus, that can help you, mentor you, and be with you where you are and help you. Don't find yourself a Hollywood star, please, and chase after that. That's not who you are. You're a kingdom child. You're a kingdom person. Say with me, kingdom. I'm part of the kingdom of heaven. That's who you are. We're a kingdom people. And I think, you know, it's important to say that without the Holy Spirit, we will not have a relationship with the Father. And we will not have a relationship with Jesus because he's the one who presents us to the Father. And I want to validate this, obviously, from the Word of God. Galatians 4, 6-7. And if you study Romans 8, if you study Galatians 4, you will find the work of the Holy Spirit of adoption in both these passages, because the Word of God says, and because we are his children. You see, sometimes I think we hear we are God's children, but we don't have a cooking clue what that means. We do not understand that it determines our identity in the Lord. He says, so, and because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, gift of the Holy Spirit, baptized with the Holy Spirit, different, very different from just knowing about him and believing he's with you. This is very different when God sends him in. But then he says, prompting us to call Abba. This word Abba, I've said it numerous times, is the Aramaic word and it means papa, daddy. Some people say, Pastor, please, that's disrespectful. Don't say he's your daddy. What you don't understand is that the Word of God here wants you and me to believe that we can have a personal relationship with him. It doesn't speak, it does not address the issue of disrespect. It addresses the issue of relationship. I want to say that again, because some of you need to cry out, Papa. You haven't had an earthly model father who were like Jesus, or mother. Maybe you didn't have a family. Maybe you feel like an orphan. Maybe you feel alone. Maybe you feel that like there's no support. You've come to the right place. God wants to support you. God wants to be your daddy, your father. That speaks not of disrespect, but it speaks of relationship. Abba, this word prompt means just a simple definition to encourage somebody who's hesitant to say something or to cause action, to bring about an action or feeling. What's the point I'm making? The Holy Spirit encourages you to cry out to your Father. Now that he has become the spirit of adoption, he knows you're a child. He knows you're part of God's family. He knows you're in this kingdom. I want you to understand you're in a kingdom here this morning. Hallelujah. You're in this world, but you're no longer from this world. You're in a kingdom. Say with me, my kingdom. Say with me, my father. Abba. Papa. Daddy. Not to disrespect, but to invite into relationship. And I don't care if your earthly dad was a perfect role model, because many of us have got awesome earthly parents and fathers, but there's none of them can be ever like your heavenly father. Oh, Abba, 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 Abba. Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will testify of me. 1 Corinthians 12 verse 3 says that nobody can say Jesus is Lord without the Holy Spirit. What does Jesus say? Jesus said, you cannot know me without my Spirit. Obviously. What am I saying? Don't say that because we're Pentecostals that we focus more on the Holy Spirit than on Jesus. No. The Holy Spirit points you to Jesus. The Holy Spirit points you to the Father. Without him, we cannot call Abba. He prompts us. Without him, we cannot know Jesus. It's impossible to cultivate a personal relationship without the Holy Spirit. I want to ask you, do you have a personal relationship? You're not part of a religion. You're in a kingdom and you're part of a family. Hello, somebody. This thing we call church, you have to understand. Ecclesia, the gathering of those who have been called outside, it means that we're in a kingdom. And we have a relationship. You don't have a religion. We don't bow before other gods. We bow before the God, the creator of heaven and earth. And we pray, your kingdom come, your will be done as it is in heaven. Let it so be in my heart. Let it so be in my life. Let it so be in my family. And that's not possible if you don't start to acknowledge the person of power, the Holy Spirit of adoption. So I want to encourage you this morning. Become sensitive of the Holy Spirit. Become aware of the Holy Spirit. And make sure that you invite him and have a relationship with him. And say the words of Jesus, you are not an orphan. Quickly turn to two or three people, tell them, you're not an orphan, you're not an orphan. You're not an orphan. Jy's nie alleen nie, jy's nie niks werd nie, kom aan. En stop so my hardkoppigheid ook hier vanmôre, asseblief, en kry die vrug van die gees. Because sometimes when we talk about the Holy Spirit, it's like people's hearts are hardened. Actually, the Word of God speaks about this, and I think Acts 7, he says, always resisting the Holy Spirit. I want to ask you, sir, meneer, broer, sister, hoekom weerstaan jy die Heilige Gees? Why do you resist the Holy Spirit? Why are you afraid of him? Receive the gift here this morning. Close your eyes, lift your hands for a moment, if you want to, if you want to stand with me. I think let's stand. Let's take some time out. And in your own words, I've said a lot, but pray, invite him. Invite him, invite him. My friend, do you understand what this means? You're in a kingdom. You are family. God loves you so much that he calls you child. And he says today, remember you are a co-heir with the one who came to deliver you, Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that we will understand the power, the implication of this message. And my Father, I'm sorry. I pray for all of us and for myself. And I say, I'm sorry that sometimes live and act as if we don't know who we are. But this morning we invite the Holy Spirit to come back, to come and change our hearts and lives. And Lord, I pray that an awareness will come of who we are in you and whose we are, what we are, what we're supposed to do, where we're heading, what the purpose of this life is, Lord, because so many battle with individuality and with philosophy. So many call themselves truth seekers. We found the truth. His name is Jesus. Holy Spirit, shine. illuminate the person of Christ as only you can do. Can we just lower our hands, but close, keep our eyes closed? And I want to make this invitation. There's such a presence of God here. My sister, my brother, God receives you. You are here for a reason, and your life will never be the same again. I just sense the power of the presence of God. I sense His love. I sense His compassion, and He draws you in. And I want to ask that question I spoke of earlier. Are you sure that you're a child of God? Your name is written in Heaven's Book of Life. Was there ever a day and time where somebody made that invitation, maybe, so that you can respond by faith? And the Holy Spirit can come in and present you and testifies with your spirit that you're a child of God. If you're uncertain, maybe you used to serve God, but you're backslidden. You're no longer where you're supposed to be, but He speaks to you here this morning. And you know that God speaks. There's an invitation. There's an invitation for you to return. There's an invitation for you to be restored. There's an invitation for you to be a child of God. For your name to be written in Heaven's Book of Life. If you're uncertain and you say, yes, preacher, you speak to me this morning. While every eye's closed, every head's bowed, you quickly raise your hand so that God can do what only God can do. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Dankie, Here. Thank you, Jesus. The Holy Spirit invites you. He says, come, 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 come. That's how much God loves you. He accepts you just as you are. He's not going to leave you the same way. Don't think that He will leave you where you are. But He's inviting you so that grace and love can come and transform you to be more like, to live more like, to love more like. So I want to make this invitation today one more time, if that's you. If you've raised your hand, you don't need to raise your hand again. But if God speaks to you, you know the Spirit speaks. One more time, just raise your hand quickly where you are. If you haven't lifted your hands, thank you, thank you. And now I want us to take a step of faith further. I want to pray with you quickly. And I want you to come and join me in front here because I want to pray with you. It's not to shame you. By the way, this is not something to shame people. This is between you and God. Your life never be the same again. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Kom tot bekering. Kom repent. Kom sê, Here, verander my. Here, kom raak my aan. Dankie. Dankie, dankie. Kom ons sit ons, let's put our hands together. Are there more people? Quickly come if there's more people. Yes, Lord, thank you, thank you. Gesinne, kom. Families, come. Young people, come. Oh, Lord, thank you. There's a stir, there's a touch, there's a spirit that moves. You know what? I just want to say to the people in front here, as a young man, there in Stilfontein, I came, I gave my heart and life to the Lord. I never came out. I always just put up my hand. That evening, I came out. I was so afraid. What's my mom and dad going to think about me? They're going to think I'm naughty because I was in a hostel, in a boarding school there in Potchefstroom. But that night, I came out. And when I came out, because it's faith. You say, why am I here? It's faith. Say with me, faith. I believe that God has spoken and I react to that call. And nothing will be the same again. I believed that night and nothing was the same again. And the Lord filled me. And the Holy Spirit, I received the gifts of the Holy Spirit not long after that. And here I am today preaching and on fire for Jesus. And see my city safe. And see my family safe. And see families safe and changed for the glory of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Getting people to become part of the family. And therefore I want to congratulate you this morning. We serve a good God. And I want our ushers to be ready at the info desk and ask you if you go out this morning. Just give us your information because we have to journey together. We're family now. Ons is nou familie. Asseblief moenie wegraak nie. Because that is what religious systems teach us. You go through a protocol. And I don't want to mention the different protocols because you will exactly know of what denominations I'm talking. But our denomination has a protocol of it all. Protocols doesn't save people. This saves people. Respond to the word of God by faith. That saves people. Protocol, I've seen people getting baptized and then they think the protocol is set and done and you never see them again. Protocols does not save people. The presence of God. Responding in faith, giving your heart and life to Jesus. So I want you to close your eyes and I want the church to pray with me together and I want you to repeat this prayer after me right now. Say, Father God, thank you so much that I can call you Father, Abba. I believe in my heart, confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. He died for my sins and he was raised from the dead on the third day. Jesus, I surrender to you. I'm sorry for what I've done. I'm sorry for drifting away from you. But this morning, I come wholeheartedly and say, lead me again, Lord. Holy Spirit, I pray, fill me. I receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit of adoption, I honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. I just want to come and give you a hug. Come on, let's put our hands together for these people. I'm so proud of you. And that's the wonderful thing, you know, when the Holy Spirit of adoption starts to do his work, you see tears. Why? Because, and don't mistake this for emotion. It's not emotion. It's the presence of God doing a work of regeneration in our hearts, giving us the nature of Jesus. Some smile, and by the way, you don't have to cry. That it's not measured that way, but I've seen it so many times. God bless you. Young man, your lewe gaan verander. Jy sal sien, alles gaan verander. Papa gaan verander. Mama gaan verander. Everything changes when Jesus comes. Thank you. My brother, you've got such a big work to do. I'm so glad you're here. You will never be the same again. You know the word Isaac, hallelujah. Yeah, it's a biblical name, and there's a call of God on your life. Well, my sister, bless you. My brother, hallelujah. Tears everywhere, hallelujah. God's doing a great thing, restoring family. God's doing a new thing in this family, in Jesus' name, hallelujah. Die Here raak hierdie familie aan. You've been trusting God for things. The breakthrough hasn't come. You're afraid, you're worried. But I break that over your life. I speak over your life. Be free from that fear, that worry. In this week, things start to change. I prophesy it over your life. In Jesus' name, give God a big praise. Hang in there. Hang in there. There's a period and a season of suffering and toughness. But that gives you and affords you the opportunity to persist in your faith. Persistent faith is a whole different level of faith. There's a great call of God on your life. God's going to open doors that no man can shut. You will look back at these days and say, God, thank you for what you've done. Don't put a time to it. You will see the change happening slowly but steadily. But hang in there. Glory to God. Wat 'n mooi gesin. Bless these people in Jesus' name. Young man. Hallelujah. Geef mij een druk. Never be the same again. Go change the township in Jesus' name for the glory of God. Invite your family, invite your friend. Father, a tongue of fire on this man to reach where no one else can reach in Jesus' name. Luan, je weet als een roeping op jou leven. Yes, there's a call upon your life. Serve God. You will lead many and thousands to the Lord. Hallelujah. Pastor Luan, dames en heren. Come on, give the Lord a big praise. I speak life. I speak blessing. I speak restoration in Jesus' name. And remember, as predecessors and heirs, we are called to go and love and seek and save the lost. So next week, there won't be enough room in this church. Can I get an amen? Because we want others to experience the presence of God. Because it's all about Him. Hallelujah. I love you. In Jesus' name, please don't forget to give us your details. And the usher team, let's be vigilant. If we're not vigilant collecting information, we're not loving the people. But our people love people. Hallelujah. Thank you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you so much for coming out today. And I just want you to just close your eyes there where you are. This is Pentecost Sunday. Maybe you haven't received the gift of the Holy Spirit. And I want to lead you in a prayer that you will receive Him. And I promise to do this. We will have more messages on the person of the Holy Spirit. And I want to talk about the gift of the Holy Spirit more, that you may understand. Because when we understand and we hear the word, faith comes. So, but before, we don't have time this morning, but I want to just pray over you. As a matter of fact, just pray this prayer after me. Will you do that before we conclude? Say, Father, thank you so much that I can say Abba. And as my Father, I thank you for a wonderful gift, the gift of the Spirit. This morning, I open my heart and I invite you, precious Holy Spirit, I receive you as a gift from my Father. Jesus, you are the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. Baptize me this morning. I receive the gift. Fill me now in Jesus' name. And can we give the Holy Spirit a big praise in this place? Holy Spirit, we honor you. We love you. Pastor Carl, I know you want to talk, and I'm going to give over because there's so teenwoordigheid here. I don't want to get off this pulpit. Hallelujah. How many of you love the presence of God and His anointing and His glory? Dankie, Here. Is jy nog hier?
Hallelujah. Have you been blessed? Wow. Come on, let's give Jesus just one more praise this morning. Just a few announcements. Please take note that this week we continue still, like every week, with our women's and men's prayer meeting happening weekly. We do it on Wednesday morning for the women, 5 o'clock. We do it online so you can join in from your home. And you heard right, yes, 5 o'clock in the morning, 5 a.m., hallelujah, right before you start your day, we're praying as ladies together. And then also on Friday, the men are coming together and they pray at 5 o'clock in the morning. Believe me, you don't want to miss out on these prayer meetings. That's so powerful. God is doing something in our nation, in our city, because there are people waking up and praying at 5 o'clock, hallelujah. Amen. So, and then please take a note of some announcements in our toddlers area. There is some children's clothes that have been donated to the church. You're welcome after the service to go and have a look and take what you need there. There will be ushers there assisting you, but please take note of that. And then next Saturday is a very big Saturday here at our church. We're going to have our leaders' empowerment happening right here at JFN. It's going to start the morning, 9 o'clock until 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I want to encourage you, really, you don't want to miss this. It's going to be such a powerful, spirit-filled Saturday where you're going to become equipped, get ready to do the work of God, to be like, love like, live like Jesus. That's happening next week, Saturday. But we need you to register. If you don't register, you might not get food. Amen. Please register at the info desk. There are lists there. Please, we're going to have an awesome Saturday. Bring your family, bring your people. We're going to have a great time next Saturday. And then the other announcement is on the 9th of June, we're going to have our Fellowship Sunday here at church. On that Sunday morning, we're going to do something special. We're going to eat together as a family, as people. We're going to have normal service afterwards, spend some time together here at church. So if you have not yet found yourself within a group, you don't know where to connect, you don't know where you're going to sit, whose soup and bread you're going to eat from, amen. Please, also at the info desk, you can register there. And luckily, there's no names of the soups that are going to be made yet, so you can't pick and choose at the moment, right? But go write your name. We're going to divide you and make sure that you are part of the family, hallelujah, that you are a son and a daughter in the house of God, because you have come here and you're filled with the Holy Spirit. And then on the 16th of June, please take note, we're going to have our Father's Day service. I would love to just read to you a scripture this morning for our tithes and offerings. It comes out of Philippians 4, verse 15 to 19. It says, As you know, you Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help when I first brought you the good news. And then Paul continues to write, he says, they are a sweet-smelling sacrifice that is acceptable and pleasing to God. And this same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from His glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus' name. And I love the scripture so much because it talks about the involvement of the people in the church of God. Amen. People took their finances, and I believe this was above and beyond their normal tithes and offerings. They supported Paul. They were interested. They had a purpose in supporting Paul because Paul was the one who was bringing the good news to the people all around them. Amen. They took their role as the church seriously. Hallelujah. When you are part of the church, it means you also worship God with your finances. It means you are serious about what's happening here on Sunday mornings, what's happening throughout the week. We all have a role to play. The Philippian church took their financial responsibility serious. And tithing and offering and sowing is a pleasing sacrifice unto God. And the scripture continues to say that God will continue to provide. Many times we don't want to tithe and sow because it's not in our budget. But let me tell you, when you trust God, you place your hope in Him. Amen. He is the one that fills up the gaps. He is the one that makes the budget work, even though it doesn't look like it should work. So this morning, I want to encourage you to a next level of faith. A faith where you trust God to make a way for you. But faith requires bold action. Hallelujah. It requires you to say, I'm part of this church. I'm part of this family. I'm going to support what God is doing here. So for a moment, I would love for you to just get your tithes and offerings ready. Grab it into your hand for a moment. I want to pray with you. Amen. Let's close our eyes. Lord, thank you so much, God. This word says, you provide for us out of your glorious riches, Lord. Thank you, God, that we can first off acknowledge today that you are our provider, not our employer, not our business, God, not any person, but you are our provider. And we thank you today that you are faithful above all and you never forget us, Lord. I thank you also this morning that we can be part of this body, that we can sow, God, and see the seeds start to grow, to see the impact that we make as a church in our city, in our community, in the lives of the people. Thank you, Lord, this morning that we can come and worship you with our finances. In Jesus' name, Lord, we love you, Lord. Amen and amen.